In a country like this, how dare you come out and say you are gay?
We don't want such thing in our country because, I mean, it's on African.
These laws were often put in place by my own country.
Within Africa ourselves, what we need to learn about each other, I think, is the deep level of diversity that we have, particularly when it comes to things that may seemingly be outside of the norm. Queer people have existed in Africa since the beginning of time, and this is something that we as Africans, we need to understand. We're trying to shift the narrative by creating as much content that just tells our stories and get them out into the world.
Watching Concubinage in Africa. To start with, most of us might have heard from history class that one of the oldest and most pervasive illusions about Africa is the idea that gender diversity and homosexuality are either non-existent or incidental. Despite their prevalence in African Islamic royal situations, concubines are an understudied subject in the field of African history studies. Although it sounds like something from a bizarre fiction book, this event actually occurred in African history, and you won't believe how common they were back then. Concubinage is a system in which powerful men, such as kings, nobles, and wealthy merchants, maintain women or men as their sexual companions. These powerful men frequently displayed their male concubines at ceremonies and public occasions, showcasing their attractiveness and desirability. As a result, people who have concubines are often seen as wealthy and influential. African empires are the term used in African studies to describe a number of pre-colonial African kingdoms with multinational systems that, typically by conquest, merged numerous populations and polities into a single entity. During this era, African rulers used to have male concubines all the time, as much as they also had female concubines on the side. While we mentioned that male concubines were pretty popular, they were a distinctive aspect of various African dynasties, and they led lifestyles that were unheard of. But still, this does not erase the fact that they existed, and most African rulers would prefer their company, male concubines and their roles. Male concubines were originally associated with ancient Greece or Rome, but as mentioned above, African empires encouraged this idea too. But did these concubines live a life of glamour, riches, privileges, or rivalry just like the ones we see in imperial films? Or was it a complete misery? Well, prominent leaders of Africa kept male concubines for various reasons. It might be for reasons to form alliances or show subordination. The reasons are endless. But most of the time, the concubines were often utilized as political tools and presented to other monarchs as presents or tributes. It has been centuries since this blasphemous practice began, but this was just relevant in several African regimes. At the same time, male concubines played a vital role in court life. This means they indeed have a complex position and prestige inside the royal courts. They occasionally received privileges and affluence that most people could only imagine, and as a result, were always pampered with fine clothing, jewelry, and luxurious living quarters. Lastly, one of the most important roles that a male concubine had to play in the lives of their rulers was to give pleasure and companionship in sexual services. Male concubines were often valued and adored for their beauty, wit, and loyalty. Some even attained positions of authority and influence within the court, serving as the ruler's advisors or in charge of managing specific facets of the administration of the kingdom. Another good thing is that male concubines enjoyed the protection and patronage of their masters. The practice of male concubinage had a significant impact on African empires, societies, and cultures. One of the significant impacts includes ideas on gender roles and relationships. The presence of male concubines changed the traditional adherence to masculinity, feminism, and the idea of monotonous relationships. It was a discipline that permitted some gender and sexual experimentation, which could be both liberating and frightening. As a result, social hierarchy became more fluid, frequently at variance with conventional notions of position and authority. The life of a male concubine was not a walk in the park. While there were kings who treated their male concubines with respect, there were still others who did the complete opposite. And sadly, male concubines who fell out of favor with the king were punished severely. While the life of male concubines in ancient Africa is not as simple as it seems, it is undeniable that they left a mark on the country's society. At most, they opened possibilities for people to see that gender can be fluid, and there's nothing wrong with that.
He's gone, Kaiba. Gone forever.